week from Wednesday is okay, and we cover.
When is that coming?
Week from one another.
So we play.
So it will cover, so the exam, when we have it, will cover basically chapters 1, 2, and 4, which right now we're sort of partway into 4. I can make it a week later if you want. It just means, so people have a chem test 2 weeks.
I have enough chem test 2 weeks.
So a week from Wednesday is okay for everyone?
Yes. Yep.
Okay, then it will be here a week from Wednesday.
Okay.
Fine. So during class time, yes. The exams in this class are during class time except the final. The final is during final time. Okay, so last time, we were looking at functions from R1 into Rn, which we can think of as vector-valued functions. So we looked at something like f of t is a vector. I'm going to just write it generally. f1 of t, f2 of t, fn of t. For example, ft is sine t cosine t of t. That's a vector or a triple, I don't care. Something like that, which describes, let's see, now the way I did it, since I started with sine, it must start here, and the sine increases, so it's at the helix. Something like that, right? So we talked about that. Maybe I screwed it up a little bit. And then we talked about what dt of such a thing. So this is a vector, which is just f prime, f2 prime, fn prime. So it's just the vector of derivatives of the components. And that corresponds to the tangent vector to this curve at time t, right? Talked a little bit about that, how that works. This is also the limit as h goes to 0 of the vector t plus h minus the vector t over h. So it's the same definition, except that this is a vector, this is a vector. So we get a vector in, we push it by a real number, and we get a vector out. That's what we did last time. What I neglected to do last time, so I want to take a few minutes to do, is, so we know about derivatives, let's think about what an integral would be. So certainly we can just define the integral of this vector value function t dt. Well, this, we can just define it to be the vector which consists of integrating each of the components as a vector. So we can certainly define it to be that. So this is a vector. We'll get a constant of integration. So we get a constant here, which will be a vector. So the constant of integration is another vector. See? So this will be another vector valued function. Let me call it G. Plus some constant of integration like that, with the property that the derivative of this guy is that one. Right? Nothing hard here. You just integrate term by term and it gives you a thing. And that thing that it gives you, well, you see that since this is the velocity vector, then this guy should be a vector. Those are vectors. Should be a vector that takes velocities and turns them into a position. Antiderivative. So if I tell you how a thing is moving, and I give you an initial condition, then you know where it is. Right? So I guess maybe stupid example. So let's say, I'll just use that same example. So suppose that the velocity vector is, let's call it vt, which is given by something like, well, let's just put it in two dimensions, sine t, cosine t. Should I put it in three dimensions? Yeah. So suppose that the velocity vector is sine t, cosine of t, and I want to find a function. This, well, this will not give me an answer. I would need with the initial position being, I don't know, 1, 0. Or I could do 1, 1, doesn't matter. So this is saying that I know that my thing starts here. And then that I know that the velocity, as it moves at each point, well, let's see, sine, cosine, that as it moves around, I tell you the vector, which says how it moves. So this is at time t equals 0. It's here, that's the vector. Some later time, it's over here, that's the vector, and so on. So we're putting together these collection of vectors that tell you how the point moves, just in terms of calculus, we just integrate sine t, cosine t, dt, and that gives us, well, the integral of the sine is the cosine, except it's negative, and the integral of the cosine is the sine, and then there's some constant. And that constant I need, well, that constant seems to be the 0. So that was a stupid example. Okay, let's make it 1, 1. So now, t equals 0 is like 0. Okay, so I have that, and I need to use the fact that minus cosine of 0 plus C1 is 1, and that the sine of 0 plus C2 is 1. So that tells me that C1 cosine of 0 is minus 1, I guess is 2. Did I do that right?
Yes.
Yeah, I guess so. And that C2 is 1. So that means that my function isn't really what I drew because I was wrong. Well, not quite. Is the function f of t is minus cosine t plus 2 sine t plus 1. It's just doing the same antiderivative problems that you do with one variable, except we have n of them to do. And that also tells me exactly where the point is and its future path. You can, I mean, those of you that you do this sort of thing in physics all the time in a mechanics class.
No.
Well, okay, if you're in that class, then you do this, and if you're not, you don't. It's okay. You know, where you know the forces acting on the thing, and you want to figure out how the thing moves. That's exactly this. Giving you how it moves, how its speed goes, and where it started, and you figure out where it goes. The problem is exactly the same as the one-dimensional problem. It's just several one-dimensional problems. Another, so I don't want to do, you know, 37 of these. I think, is there anybody that doesn't understand what I'm doing that is willing to do? Okay. Another thing, if you think back to what you do with integrals, I mean, areas doesn't really make sense here. There is a way to interpret things as areas, but we're not quite there yet. So we can't think of this as an area under a curve. But another thing that we do with integrals, which is very natural in this context, remember this is related to curves. So I'm telling you how a thing moves, both what direction it's go, how its direction changes, and how its velocity changes. And then we figure out what the thing is. But another example would be arc length. So in calculus one, maybe you remember, we have some graph y equals f of x, and we want to figure out how long the curve is. This is a terrible pen. How long this piece of curve is. And the process that you go through in calculus one is, you just draw the same picture again, just bigger, that you write it as a collection of little chunks of width delta x, and then you integrate the length of each of these chunks, and of course this chunk here is related to the slope. We have to use the Pythagorean theorem, where the base is delta x, the height is something related to the derivative, that this is delta x f prime of x. So you do all of this stuff and you arrive at the formula that the arc length is the integral of the square root of 1 plus the derivative squared x from x0 to x1. People sort of vaguely remember this formula, maybe not, but it comes down to doing this kind of thing and then letting the sizes shrink to zero and so on. But this is actually much more natural, let's do it here, in the context of a parametric equation. This is actually easier. So again, I'm thinking I have some function which parameterizes my curve, and I'm going to draw it in two variables, but it doesn't matter if it's two or five variables. I have my function here. And if I just go a little bit, so on some small range, this is f of one t, and here's f of another t, and this vector between them, well, actually let's think about it a different way. Let's do it a different way. I have a vector that tells me how far I move in a unit time. Right? The derivative vector here is how far f goes in a unit time. Well, infinitesimal. And if I were to just add up all of these speeds, then that should give me the length. So the length is just going to be the sum of the speeds over a small time period times how far you went. And then I take delta t going to 0, so this converges to the integral of the speed dt. Right? So that formula actually becomes very simple. It's the same formula. So what is the speed? The speed is the length of the velocity vector. Right, just how long the vector is. I don't care which way it goes, I just care how long it is. So that means that the arc length is just going to be the integral of velocity vector dt. That's it. And let's see that it's the same as the original thing. So if I have, say, y equals f of x, I want some other thing. Y equals g of x, that means that I can think of this as the parametric equation. F vector is x of x, right? This gives me the graph. And so let's just see that that's the same. So here, if I take the derivative of this, so the derivative vector is 1 g prime of x, vector. I just take the derivative of this guy, I get that, and I'm running low on space here, so I guess I'll go there, sorry. And so that means then that the integral is the integral from my given starting to my given ending of the length of that vector. Well, the length of that vector is 1 squared plus g prime of x squared dx, which is exactly the same formula that you hated in calculus 2. Or calculus B, or BC, or whatever name you call it. When you were doing applications of integration, this is the formula that we got. So they're the same. But this one is easy to understand. And this one involves some messing around with the Pythagorean theorem and slopes and stuff. This is sort of a very natural representation. And this one is just what it works out to be. This is a formula you can remember. This is a formula you have to figure out every time you want to use it. So I guess, let's just use the same example. I'll just move backwards today. So the arc length of a piece of the helix h of t is sine t cosine t. Well, this one's parameterized by arc length, which is kind of stupid, but t from t equals 0 to, I don't know, 2. Well, that's a vector. The derivative vector is cosine t minus sine t 1. Its length is always square root of 2. And so its length is 2 square root of 2. So the length is the integral from 0 to 2 of the square root of 2 to t, which is 2. Of course, if I make this harder, I make this a t squared, then this becomes a 2t, and then this becomes the square root of 2 plus 2t, and then it's not as easy, but it's still doable, and so on. Right? Okay. Any questions on this stuff? So this was leftovers from last time that, oh, it works again. So now I'm kind of done with, so if you remember, our goal, my goal, whoever's goal, the goal, is to understand calculus in functions from n variables into m variables. And then, so last time, we did the easy case of n equals 1, and m was n because n's are easier to write than m's. So now, so last year, n equals 1, m equals 1, last time, and a little bit today, n equals 1. This is easy, we're done. We'll come back to it a little bit, but we're kind of done here. And so the next natural thing is m equals 1. So we want to now turn to functions. I'm still going to use f because f is a function. It's not a vector anymore. F is a function that eats n variables and gives me one variable back. So as an example, f of xy is x squared plus, let's do something like that, x squared plus y cubed plus 1. So here I have two independent variables that I combine, and out comes another variable. Another example would be you just square everything and add it up. Something like that. And so, I mean, we can obviously use various powers and various things. We can put them together and put it. Okay, so this guy is a function. I put in four numbers, out comes one number. Here I put in two numbers, out comes one number. This case, we can draw. This case we have to think a little harder about. But so let's mostly focus on a graph. Mostly, we'll focus on this case a lot because we can draw it. But we can also think about other cases. So one tool which is really useful in calculus of one variable graph is having the graph is a handy thing. Now in this context, how many of you don't know what the graph is? Okay, at least there's 1, 2, 3 semi-honest people, or okay, a few more honest people is good. Some of you do, I know. So let's think about what the graph would be in the case where I only have two variables. Well, let's think about the graph in one variable. We draw a line, this is my input, and we draw another line, which we call x. So this is y equals f of x. This is my output. And then we just plot all of the points, all of the pairs, x, y, so that, well, they're really x, f of x. And that gives us the graph. So the height here, the height at x is f of x. And that gives us the graph. Now, if we want to generalize this to more input variables, but still one output variable, then do a similar thing, only now we should think we have lots of inputs. So I have a whole, in this case, a plane, but you can think of your plane as being a six-dimensional hyperplane if you want. And then I have one output, which gives me a height. So I'm thinking that going in, let me draw it red, I have some inputs, and I'm going to turn, well, doesn't matter. Let's just be conventional. So that's my x's and that's my y's. So you turn. Right, that's my x's and my y's going in. And then for each guy who goes in, so here's some typical point, x naught, y naught. I go up to the height of f of x naught, y naught. And I do that everywhere. So my inputs are like a sheet of paper. And I raise the sheet of paper and bend it around by the amount given by the function. So here, I should have something sheet of papery like as my outputs. Made a mess. Where the height of each thing on this surface is given by my function. So this is the graph of the function. Two variables. It's a little harder to think about what the graph of the function in three variables would be. I would take a space, and I would move every point in that space up a certain amount, but up has to be in the fourth dimension. It's a little hard to draw that. Right? So in the fourth dimension, I'll take a cube going in, and then in the fourth dimension, it will become something else. That's a terrible picture. Wow. Anyway. So I can draw some. Let me see if I can get this computer to draw.
draw some, because that's sort of better, provided that I can figure out. I don't want the audio display. Let's play. Okay, come on. So let me, well, let's do an easy one. Let's think about the easy one while I'm waiting for the computer to do whatever it is it's supposed to do. So let's think about, say, z equals, I don't know, x squared plus y squared plus 1. So what would that look like? Oh, here we go. Good. So think about what that would look like. So how can you figure out what that would look like? Well, one way to figure it out is think about what slices look like. So this is f of x, y. So think about what f of x and some constant like 0 would be. This will be a function x squared plus 1. Oh, sorry. And, oh, come on. That's what I mean to type. Okay, so on here there's a 3D graphing applet, and I'm just going to pop out this window. Don't tell him.
Run.
Where's run? Run. Always run.
Sure.
Thank you. And should I turn the lights down? Does it matter? Come on, say I accept. Yes, of course I accept you. Let me hold your run on the lights. So let's, well, there we go. So this one here, let me make it minus 2 instead of plus 1. So should I dim the lights? Is it good? You don't care? Either way? All right, fine. So this looks like a paraboloid, fine. But let's think about it. If you notice each of these slices that we're seeing here, of course I can't ever seem to get them straight. Graph. I told you to graph. Okay. Right. Graph. Each of these slices, if we look, can never spin these things straight. You see a bunch of parabolas going this way, and a bunch of parabolas, well, if I spin it, going the other way, there they are. Of course, it fell over, but that's okay. And that's exactly what's happening if we take a grid in the xy plane, and you not pay attention to who's x and who's y, these lines this way, well, they're graphs if I think of putting a standard xz this way. The graph of this line is going to be a parabola whose vertex is at height negative 2 when y is 0. As y increases, the vertex goes up. So if I put y this way, as y increases, the vertex goes up. So I get a bunch of things. And as y increases in the negative direction, the vertex goes up. So I get a bunch of things like that. If I make the slices in the other direction, I get the same sort of thing. Here, when x is 0, that's supposed to be a parabola?
Sure.
When x is 0, I get parabolas that look like that. As I increase x from 0, they move up. And as I decrease x, they move up. That's exactly what you're seeing in this picture. Well, I turned off the wrong lights. Okay. That's exactly what we're seeing in this picture here. Right? Parabolas which move as I move x and y. This, you know, the best way to get used to these things is just play around with them. One thing that this will do, you can click a point and drag it around. This is my input. Here is my input, which gets wrapped up to the surface, and you can't really see it because of the coloring. Let me take just another function. This function instead, which is some complicated thing, has some bumps and stuff, which is, what is that? 7xy times over e to the x squared plus y squared. Okay. Whatever. It's a function, got a couple of bumps on it. As I move this point around, you can see the point. Well, I can see the point. I don't know if you can. Moving around on the surface, you should imagine that this base point here is sitting under here, and it gets lifted up to the surface by that amount. Okay? I think what I'm going to do, since I want to come back to this, is I'm going to turn off this one. One of them should have gone off. No? Neither one of them went off. I want to make it go away. Okay, I turned that one off. I meant to turn the other one off, but okay. I'm going to leave this up because I'm going to, oh great, we're going to have blue. It's supposed to go off. All right, so I want to talk a little more and then keep pointing at this. So there are various things we can do. You know, you don't need a computer to figure these things out, but it does make it easier. There are various things we can do, which I sort of mentioned. Suppose that I have a function. So let's just use that one. Let's use the one I had before. X cubed, x squared plus y cubed plus 1. Suppose I have that function. And I don't have my computer. I mean, I do have my computer. It's there. But let's assume I don't, and let's figure out what this is going to look like. Does anyone have a feeling for what this would look like? That's part of it. Yeah?
I'm sort of halfway through this thought process, uh-huh. But well, if you do what you did before and set y equals 0 and x equals to 0, along the, I guess, the y-axis, it would sort of shape to a parabola, and along the x-axis, or maybe I'm reversing it, but it would shape into sort of like an x-cubed-looking function, and I can't really visualize that in my brain right now.
So let's work on doing it.
No, the first
so this is true. f of x and a constant is a parabola.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. And f of constant y is a cubic. And let's think about what these parabolas look like. This parabola is x squared plus something that depends on a constant, which changes in y. So here, it looks like x squared plus c, where c is y cubed plus 1. So that means as y increases, c increases. And as y decreases, in other words, y negative, c decreases. So the slices fixing x and allowing y to vary are going to be curves. So this is x, z, and y is some constant. Are going to be curves that look like this. And they move up and down. They move up as y goes up, and they move down as y goes down. If we look at this part, oops, did I just do the wrong thing? Yeah, sorry. These are parabolas. Sorry, just read the wrong line. These are parabolas that move up and down as y moves up and down. So let's not think about how they move up and down. So if I look in the x, y plane and I cut this thing, every cross section is going to give me some kind of a parabola, like this. And these cross sections are going to go down. They go through 1, 0. The origin is at 1. But I get something that looks sort of like this. But it's not as flat as I drew it. Right, it looks like a piece of pipe cut in half. But it moves around. Now let's look at the other cross section. The other cross section So if we did an easier one where this is like one where this is just x squared plus y, we would just get a nice funnel shape, a nice half pipe. Right? If I did g of xy is x squared plus y, I would get a nice half pipe kind of shape. But that's not what I have. Okay, let's look at the other slice. If I do x equals constant, then here, oh, sorry, I'm drawing the picture in x is constant, so in yz land, I get a cubic that looks something like this, and it moves up or down. But here, this cubic, I have f of x, some constant k, x of some constant y is y cubed plus 1 plus k squared. Now the thing to notice here is this is always bigger than 1. And as k is positive or negative, it does the same thing. So it will come down and go back up. Well, that corresponds to these things, right? So here, k equals 0 means that this is at 1. And then k bigger than 0 will be up higher. And also k less than 0 will be up higher. So that means that this pipe shape will actually have a The vertex along this pipe will move down, flatten out. Yes.
Are you sure it's the right graph?
Yeah. Yeah. I could. Yeah, just a second. Let's finish this one. So x squared plus 1 plus y cubed. Okay, and I don't want that one. So go. You should go away. I want you to graph that. So you see, it's sort of like this parabola thing. In this direction, it looks like parabolas, but in this direction, it looks like cubes. So one slice one way. Can never manage to keep these things straight. Graph. Oh, I lost you. Graph. So I get cubics in one direction, and in the other direction I get parabolas.
So we should turn them down.
So you can sort of sit in. Yeah.
So that graph should be opposite. That graph should. To the opposite.
Well, I didn't tell you where the axes were. Right? I didn't really draw the axes. I have it backwards, you're right. I'm looking from the wrong side. Okay. So, I mean, you know, we can do this for hours on end if you want. I think what's important is that you get a feel for how to combine these things and what these graphs are telling you, but this is not, you know. So you can just think about this, but the important thing to realize is we get these things we understand already from calculus one in certain directions. Now, another useful piece of information to figure out what these graphs might look like is yet another way of drawing these things is this notion of level curves. So I have z equals f of xy, and one way that I can sort of slice it up, one thing I can do is look at x constant, look at y constant. That's what I did here. But there's no reason I could also z equals constant. So that gives me something called a level curve or a contour plot. And this is actually what you see if you like look at a weather map or many other kinds of maps. So here, what I want to do is plot. So here, I want to plot. That pen's no better. I should start collecting the bad ones. I want to plot f of x, y equals constant for various values. This one's going to be here.
You took a one.
Oh, sorry. It's all right. So that is, I mean, in this case, it's a little harder. Let's do the x squared plus y squared one again. Well, so I want to look at, so I have that, and this gives me implicit curves. This doesn't give me graphs. So I get x squared plus y squared, let's start with 0, equals 0. So here I'm going to just look in the x, y land, What x's and y's satisfy x squared plus y squared equals 0? There's exactly one. That point. Now I look at x squared plus y squared equals, I don't know, a half? Maybe a quarter. What's that? It's a circle of radius a half. That's this one. Now I look at x squared plus y squared. How about I just do it in general? Equals r squared gives me a circle of radius r. So I see that all of my slices in the horizontal direction are going to be circles. And I get nothing. I'll write it up here. I get nothing for z less than 0. So that's telling me that in terms of my graph, there's nothing below the xy plane. It's all up here. And the cross sections that I get are a bunch of circles that grow with height. And the only question is, how did they grow? Do they grow like a cone, or do they grow like a parabola, or do they grow in some other way? But we already know that they grow like a parabola. It's possible, but those are not the things that I was solving. Right? Remember, what I'm drawing here is height equals x squared plus y squared. So I have this surface here, and I'm just taking out my chainsaw, and I'm cutting it off at a certain height, or maybe my lightsaber. And I cut it off at a certain height, and what I'm left with is a circle. And if I cut it off at some other height, I get another circle. Yes?
So when we're holding z constant, that's like it's like a topographical map?
Kind exactly. Of it's exactly like a topographical map or a weather map. I mean, here, let's see, I have it, or I could have it here. I think it's already in here. There it is. That one's minus 2. Let's get rid of the minus 2. So there's the function. Plot it. Where does it go? There it is. And I can say, okay, show me the contours. Oops, except I drew the wrong contours, didn't I? Crap, that's wrong. I want these contours. Sorry. Try that again. Draw the contours, and I have to make sure I select the right function. So there's the contours, which is this collection of circles at constant height. And then in this thing, if I click on it, it shows me, oh, it stops spinning, okay. It shows me the surface. There they are, spinning around, falling over, with these contours labeled for me. It's exactly like a topographic map. Okay, stop spinning. If you look from the top, you see the topographic map. If you look from the side, you see the thing ruled in that way. If I take a more complicated one, like, I don't know, let's just use this first one again. So this bumpy guy, and if I draw the contours for the first guy, there they are. And if I look at them on the surface, stop spinning around, you see them. There it is from the top, but there it is from the sides. It's exactly like a top, it's exactly what a topographic map. So these are, if you want to walk on this surface without going up or down, these are the paths you will follow.
Excuse me, Professor.
Yeah.
This applet, is that one of the links on your
page? Yeah, it's from the page. It's this graphing applet link.
But you can do this with a lot of software. I mean, you can do this in Maple, you can do this in Mathematica, you can do this, basically anything that would be three-dimensional plotting. But you know, this one's on the web, it's ubiquitous. You just have to say, it's okay to run Java. Okay, so we have these things here. Any questions? So it takes a little while to get used to visualizing these things. But these kinds of maps you see all the time. You see topographical maps. You see weather maps, which show you bands of equal pressure or equal temperature. All of those kinds of things are contour maps. They are describing, you know, we're looking at a map of Long Island, and we want to see how the temperature, well, it's not going to vary enough on Long Island. We're looking at a map of the United States, and we see that it's really hot in Texas, and it's cold in Minnesota, and you can see these lines of constant temperature. Okay. So, this is no calculus here. This is just... Why do we need to do this?
Yeah.
Well, because you're only used to graphing in one variable. Being able to graph in more than one variable is another way to display more information. In fact, if I wanted to graph with two input variables and two output variables, I could choose one to be, for example, the height and the other one to be the color. And that would be a way of displaying a function from R2 to R2. It's just a little hard for you to think of it that way, but there are ways to display this stuff. So why do we need to do this? Why do you draw graphs in the first place? They tell you stuff about functions. But everything you do with the graphs, you can also do just by calculating. But having the graph helps you have intuition of how this calculation goes. I suppose I should say something about standard, like the quadrant surfaces. Let me push that up. I'll come back to that. Should I do that? We got 20 minutes. No, let's do some calculus. Well, I'll say about the quadrant surfaces. That one should go off too. That one doesn't know how to go off. Know that if I fix a specific x value,
Bless you.
Let's get some y value instead. So I'll fix something here. Then I can get z equals, let's call it f1 of x. I know how to do calculus on this. I know how to take its derivative. I understand this. So this is going to be some graph looking like that. This is x, this is z. I know how to take derivatives. I know how to do all that stuff already. So if I now consider what happens as I move along this line with a fixed y value, I can understand how the function for the fixed y value will change. Right? So this function f1, I can understand this by taking a derivative. And I'll get f prime of x, which tells me the slope as I move along the y equals constant line. And I can do that for any y, so really maybe instead of y, that should be not f1, but fy, except that's the bad notation because the other one is fx, so I shouldn't do that. Just call it. It's not good. Right? So more generally, without introducing this intermediate function, just write it again. I have z equals f of x, y. And I want to do this thing where I hold y constant and I take the derivative. So I want to look at the limit as h goes to 0, f of x plus h y minus f of x y over h. That's what this function f1 of x is as I move the y around. This has a name. This is called the partial derivative of f with respect to x. So this is the slope along y equals constant lines. There's a formula in x and y that tells me the slope if I just move along parallel to the x-axis. Right, so this is called the partial of f with respect to x. I can do the same thing in the other direction too, to get the partial of f with respect to y. This is a Russian, right? It's a round D. It's a Cyrillic D. Looks way cooler. Let's call it a K.
Six. Backwards. It's like a K.
These two partial derivatives. These are the slopes in two orthogonal directions. You have a question? I see a hand.
Hello.
So all we're doing is just like, first derivative of like x would be just like f parentheses derivative of x comma y.
I don't know what that means.
Well, like,
so should I do an example?
Yeah.
So let's do f of x, y is, I don't know, x squared sine x, y. There's some complicated function. So if I compute the partial of f with respect to x, I'm thinking this is a constant. So its derivative, I have to use the product rule and the chain rule, is going to be 2x sine xy plus y is a constant here. So x squared times the cosine of xy. But since y is a constant, I get a contribution from it. Okay. Is that what you were asking? Okay. And the partial with respect to y, x is a constant, so this will just be x squared sine xy, oops, sorry, the cosine xy times the derivative of xy, where x is a constant, will give me another x. So this is x cubed cosine xy. Right? Yeah.
We just use implicit differentiation if we want to get everything at the same time.
I don't know what everything at the same time.
Okay, if you want to, instead of doing partials of derivatives of like x and then y, you do both at the same time.
Yeah. Yeah, I don't know what that means.
So you end up
I do kind of know what that means, but.
So you could have like a plane where you have dx and dy and those are derivatives grounded. Something like that.
But if you think about it, so what is this representing? This is saying,
yeah.
I mean, yes, but not really. This is saying that how much does the function change if I increase x a little bit?
Yeah.
How much does the function change if I increase y a little bit? Now, if we want to combine them, you don't just add them together. We have a plane. We have to think about how we move in that plane, provided we have a plane. So I can put them together, but this is a function from R2 to R2.
Yeah.
Right? It's a plane. If that's what you're saying, then yes. But I wasn't quite to the tangent plane yet. Yeah?
How come some parentheses have a comma between x and y? And
because I keep accidentally writing a comma when I don't want to. All of those commas are multiplication signs. They just sort of slipped. They were little dots. Yeah, there's no commas anywhere. So, I mean, computing partial derivatives is really easy. You just have to remember everything except this variable is held fixed. It's a constant. It's easy. But you need to keep in mind what it means. Another notation for this, this is sometimes written as f subscript x. Now that is a comma of x and y. So another notation is the variable that you take the derivative with goes as a subscript. So this would be f sub y.
Do you have a preferred notation?
No. I mean this one, I mean just like f prime and df, px, which one? Well, it depends. So this is more useful when you're doing complicated formula, and this is sometimes more useful when you want to think of it as an operator than it's a function. Yeah. It's okay. Okay, so let's do another example. Give me some function involving x's and y's. Don't make it too nasty. What? Go ahead. Okay, so that's g of x, y. So now I want to compute, let's use this notation, g sub x, which is the partial with respect to x, so that means x varies, y is a constant. So this is just a number. So the derivative of a number times 2x
is 2 times that number. Now we do the other way around. G sub y, this is just a number. So the derivative of 2 number sine y is 2 number cosine y. So it's just like the thing that, you know, in calculus 1 makes some students really mad when you say, take d dx of a cosine dx, and they get mad, what's that a? I don't know what to do with the a. Or, you know, the nasty trick that you do on calculus 1 exams, this, where people say, oh yeah, that's 3 pi squared.
If you take a cross product of g sub x and g sub y at a given point, did you find the normal vector?
Well, this is not a vector yet. We're going to make it be a vector. This is a number.
Well,
this is a slope.
It's
easy to say, well, let's make it be a vector. Well, okay. We're not ready yet to make it be a vector. This is just a number. This is a number which measures a slope in a given direction.
See, if you take those two slopes, though, and you take the cross product, that gives you that.
Well, you can't take a cross product using scalars. So, yes, you can look at these things, and you can get a plane, and yeah, but we're not there yet. So let's just think of these as numbers. There's some stuff going on there, yeah. So, I mean, this is kind of like the thing you do in implicit differentiation, but not quite. It's kind of like some other stuff, but not quite. Now, if we think back to our surface, so now I want to think about, so I have my surface here, and I have some point on the surface, and what we have just calculated is the slope in the x direction. Of course, I just drew it in the y direction, but. This is the slope in the y direction. And the slope in the x direction is fx. And now I have these two slopes in orthogonal directions, so this does actually tell me something about the tangent plane. If I cut this plane in one way, fixing y, I get the line. Of course, I've just switched x's now, so I know it. That's supposed to be this black line. And if I cut fixing x, then I get something in another direction. So I can put these together to think about the tangent plane as a combination of these two slopes. And I know the slope this way, and I know the slope this way, so I know the plane between. Which is maybe what you were asking, almost kind of sort of. So in general, did I skip anything? No. So what would that mean? That would mean that I'm almost out of time. That would mean that my tangent plane z equals f of xy. Well, and let's say at AB. Certainly, this is my point. And then my slope. Well, I say that if I move in away from A a certain amount in the x direction,
I get the x derivative. And if I move away from a in a certain in the y direction, this is b, I get the y derivative. That's it. So I start at the point, and if I move, if I keep y constant, I keep yb, this is zero. And the amount that the x increases is this derivative. And if I move in the other direction, keeping x constant, the amount that the y increases is this amount. So this actually gives me the tangent plane. So the normal vector here is fx, fy, negative 1. But sure, you can read off the normal vector that way. Because really, I should think of this that way. Okay, whatever. So maybe. Maybe I should stop there. It's a reasonable place to stop. I meant to talk about second partials and other things like that, but let's do that next time.